Everything was.
Everything's a progression, folks. Everything's a progression. And what's so funny is that, what's even funnier is that what was old and what we forget about comes back around again. When we get complacent about certain things, you take it off?
No.
Oh.
I'm just.
You don't trust me with your laptop?
What
happens is that when we get complacent with certain things and we think that we know everything and nothing ever happened in the past, and that's when we repeat it again. And that's what's really bad. Such as HP came up with this stuff called, it was called new memory. I really hope it was off the onion. Does anybody know what the onion is?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. I'm sure hoping it's off the onion, but if it wasn't, it was in days of old. I'm gonna go like this here real brief. In days of old, what happened was that you had lines of wire. I'll bring some wire in here one of these days that looks exactly like this. Not like that, but like this, right? And make sure it says indelible on it, no. And you'd have wire that crisscross like this. And you put these little ferrite beads right here. And every single one of these ferrite beads represented a bit of memory. This is called core logic. Core logic. Okay. Very old. And this is how you get a string of 8 of these together. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. And if I energize this spot and this spot, then this is a little core ferrite bead, piece of metal, like a ring. Okay. And what would happen is if I energize those two spots, I'd produce energy there and it would actually make this thing ring. As in with an electrical pulse. It would actually have an energy, so it would go like this. And it would hold it for a split second. But it would hold it so long enough, longer than if I was to have just dropped it and then I could refresh it again before it actually pulled down. I could have actually done some other stuff with it at the same time. So I could fill the field up, build this field fast enough, make some logic happen with that bit, and come back and refresh it again and do the same thing over and over. And that was called core logic, right? And it literally took these little ladies with little needles, stringing copper wire like this and copper wire like this through these ferrite beads. Now I've actually had some. It's really interesting. And I made a painstaking labor of love. About 5 years ago, HP said, oh, we got this new type of stuff. It's all done with nanofibers, the carbon nanofibers, and blah, 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 conductive nanofibers. And we take these nanofibers and we run them like this. We build these little beads, these little things around here, and we can refresh that memory so quick. You think I'm joking?
No, it's funny.
So just recently?
Yeah, about 4 years ago. Yeah, but the carbon nanotubes been around for a while. But I mean, their use of carbon nanotubes in core logic was just like, come on, really? But it's a step in the right direction.
Isn't that essentially electronics, though, taking
it is
stuff and making it smaller?
It is. But still, come on, HP. All right. So let's. We're going to go ahead and bring this thing down, and I. To do this, I want to kind of show you something though, okay? First of all, this point here and this point here is the same, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And this point is the same up here, and this point is the same here, and this is the point. And really, this all forms a great big, huge Wheatstone bridge, kind of like this, with an extra resistor. And this is extremely difficult to solve, okay, without doing one of two methods. And the first method is actually doing something called a Wheatstone bridge, Thevenizing the circuit. And we've covered about how we would actually take that resistor out of there, we'd actually Thevenize both sides of it at the voltage potential and with the resistances, and then we would put the two together and superposition them. Okay? That's how you're going to do it. The other method is taking one of these triangles that we've just now formed And going from a delta configuration, that's why it's called delta, the sort of Greek symbol for delta, to a Y configuration. Now, I will tell you that Jason.
You weren't going to forget my name.
I won't. I knew it was a J. Jason. So Jason went out and bought colored pencils. I heard that he made this huge score on colored pencils or colored pens. That was only for nursing or something I overheard, right?
Pens.
Is that what it is?
Multicolored pens.
I'm going to tell you, he's going to use them. And this one here, what you want is all sorts of color. But you need to keep your steps separate. Right? One of the biggest things with this whole process is understanding that you're going to try to solve for voltages here and here. Okay? You're going to be looking at these nodes. So I'm going to label this node A, B, C. I can even label this node D down here. Isn't this the same place here, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is, I can call this, I'm going to come over here and just call that E for whatever reason, and I can call that E. Alright. So if we wanted to solve for a delta to Y configuration, and it's going to be hard to do this, we would typically solve to go from delta to Y. We can go from Y to delta. Y to delta really doesn't do us a whole bunch other than put it into a schematic that we need. Other than that, we would typically take a delta and go to Y for solving our equations, right? So let me put it over here. I don't know if this yellow is going to show up on here very well. How about not?
There's yellow up there somewhere.
Take the blue. And it'll go like this. So these are my resistors. And this is, I'm going to call this R1, R2, and R3. All right?
Mm-hmm.
And the resistor that here, I'm going to call that RA. The one that's here is RB. And this one here is going to be RC. Now it's important, again, I'm going to keep on stressing this. It's going to sound like I'm harping on it. Yes, I'm going to harp on it because it's extremely important for you just to understand that we're going to be solving for these nodes. Right? Solving for the nodes. So, I'm going to take this right here, and realize that that's a node A, this is node B, and this is, let's call it C because it's next to RC, and this is our node B. If I want to know this resistor, and let's, for example, and I'm going to show you in this context here in a moment. Again, the only way for me to solve this would be to A, remove that resistor, Thevenize the circuit from both sides, make a Thevenized circuit that looks like this from one side and from the other side, and then put it in there and have a superposition of two voltage sources. That doesn't sound like fun, does it? I mean, it's just not fun, folks. I mean, but you can do it if you want. I'm just saying that it's an option. Okay? But in reality, we're not going to do that. This is what I love about this stuff. Say it. Ew.
It's working really well for you.
Yeah, it does.
Now we'll look at those pens again.
Probably indelible. Permanent, it's probably, oh, it is. It's a permanent fine point. Permanent fine point for your overhead projectors.
Why?
Does it actually say permanent?
You want to keep on using it?
I'm going to keep on.
It's already ruined.
All right. That's not ruined. I can wipe that off. See how fast it comes off? In fact, you know what the trick is? if you get a permanent marker on your whiteboard up there, you take a standard one.
An erasable one right over it.
Right over it.
You sure that one's not permanent?
Yes.
That would be.
It is a valid question.
Just going by your track record.
Bravo. That looks like spit, though.
It's because it is.
Shh. Do the same thing on the whiteboards, too. Clean it off. But then I look like a smurf.
Pretty special, huh?
I can go as a Oompa Loompa. I've got an Oompa Loompa outfit. All right. What? All right. So, to solve for this circuit here, what I would do is I would come down here and I'd make myself a little drawing like this. I would not connect it in. And again, this is R1, R2, R3 here. This is RA, RB, RC. To get this resistor, to get that resistor, and that's going to be RA, I'm going to say that RA is equal to, when we take the sum of these two, of R1 times R2, so we take the ones next to it, that's going to be between, right? And we're going to divide it by the sum of all those, so R1 plus R2 plus R3. So if this was a 10 ohm and that was 10, 20 and 30, I'd have 10 times 20 and then be 10 times 20. So this was 10 and this is 20, this is 30. 10 plus 20 plus 30. So it'd be equal to 200 divided by 60. And that would be my equivalent resistance right here. We're going to take the two resistors on the outside, multiply them, and divide them by the sum of those three resistors on the outside. Okay. And I'm going to be honest and upfront and just absolutely 100% with you on these guys. If you don't know this up front, you have to crack a book open. And I'm going to tell you the only reason why I remember it this morning is or this afternoon is because I had a class this morning, and I got to look at it again. If you would have asked me what the answer was, I would have said, I'm going to go look it up in the book, because these are the things that you want to make sure you have right. I'm going to go look it up in a book, and I'm going to make sure I have my formula correct. There's no reason to be wrong. Now, I want to know what RB is right here. That's going to be my RB. RB is going to be equal to, now here's R1 and R3, it's going to be R1 times R3 divided by the sum of them again. So that's going to be R1 plus R2 plus R3, which is going to be equal to 10 times 30 divided by 60, which is equal to 300 divided by 60, which is equal to 50 ohms. 5 ohms. And 200 divided by 60 is going to be equal to 3.33
repeating
ohms. So I've got a 10 ohm, a 20 ohm, a 30 ohm, but they're going to be replaced by 3.3, a 5 ohm, and over here, for this one here, it's going to be RC. RC, it's kind of hard for me to get that like that, is going to be equal to R2 times R3 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3. And that's going to be equal to 20 times 30 divided by 60. 600 divided by 60 is 10 ohms.
So
So I've got 3.3, 5, and 10. And I'm going to scoot this over just momentarily just so you can see what the circuit would then look like. Here's A. Here's B. Here's C. Here's that one down here, D. I'm going to have these, I'm going to put these back in green again. This one here is here. Watch out, Jason.
Miss.
That's that resistor here. This resistor is going to be here. Okay. Same resistors right there. The difference is between A and C, we no longer have this one here. We're going to put this little mirrored of like this. Now you see that these two form a series resistance, right? Mm-hmm. And these two form a series resistance.
That are parallel with the other two in series.
Right? And so then I can now make this a little bit smaller. These two are combined to make that one. These two are combined in series to make that one. Right? I got a resistor here and a resistor here. Add them together, I get this one. I got a resistor here and a resistor here. I add them together to get that one. This point here is this point right here. These two are in. Parallel. So I would just take this circuit and make it like this. And now I have a simple series circuit that goes over here to my power supply, where it was at. I would then solve for the voltage here using the voltage divider formula. I'm going to just kind of speak this out with you, and then we're actually going to do a bigger circuit, okay? Or just do the full circuit. I would do the voltage divider formula here. I'll take this voltage, or this resistance, okay, which is these two in parallel, right? And I would say that this resistance, Req, divided by RT, total resistance, right, times by the voltage source, is going to give me the voltage here. Okay. That's the voltage across this resistance right here. Which is, in fact, this voltage right here, correct? Which is, in fact, this voltage right here, correct? This voltage across this resistance is the same voltage here, correct? Because it's the combination of parallel circuits. I'm going to take these parallel circuits and open them up a little bit further, and there's that point still right there. Right there. I know the voltage right there at that point. These are two series resistances on each side, right? Mm-hmm. If I know this voltage, let's call that voltage EQ, and it's applied across two resistances, I know the voltage here. Voltage divider formula again. The voltage at C, voltage at C, voltage at C. That's fine. The voltage at C, right here, is going to be equal to the volt, this resistance, and that was called, we didn't have a number on it, it's called R6, divided by R6 plus this equivalent of RC. Times this voltage EQ. Voltage divider formula. I have a voltage that's applied here. I've got series resistances on this side. All I'm going to do is take this resistance, divide it by the total resistance of this side, and multiply it by that voltage that's applied. And I will get that voltage across that resistor. If I know the voltage across that resistor, I mean, I know that voltage right there at C. All I'm going to do is do the same thing on the other side. Take this resistor, divide it by the sum of those two resistors on that side, right? Series resistance, and multiply by the voltage of there. Then I'm going to know that voltage at B. So I'll have the voltage at B and the voltage at C and the voltage at A. I'm going to take this right back here. I have the voltage at B, the voltage at C. If I know the voltage here and you know the voltage here, I take the larger of the two, I subtract the smaller of them from itself, and I will know which polarity the voltage is going. Let's say that this side is 10 volts and this side is 5. How much voltage is across this resistor in the center here?
5
volts. 10 minus 5 is?
5.
I got 5 volts across it. Could I tell what the current is?
Yes.
Yeah, because I know what the resistance is there. I take the voltage of 5 volts divided by that resistance, I would know the current and the way it's going. I would have the voltage here, I would have the voltage here, right? Because I had the voltage at C, I would know the current there, I would know the current there, I know the current here. I had the voltage here, and I had the voltage here at A, right? So let's say this is 10 volts here. If this is, let's say it's 15 volts here. If it's 15 volts and this is 10, the voltage across there is?
5.
And if it's 15 volts and this is 5, what's the voltage across here?
10.
If I take the 10 volts and divide it by that resistance, I would have the current. If I take this 5 volts and divide it by this resistance, I would have the current. Once you get those voltages at A and at B and C, it cascades very quickly. I mean, you notice how I went from this circuit here, and I went back to here. I skipped a step, didn't I? Mm-hmm. Because I'm not trying to find out currents. I'm not trying to find out anything like that. I want to know what the voltages are, so that way I can get the currents in the circuit that I need to know it in. So let's do a bigger one. This is going to take a clean slate. Okay, calculators out. You have your calculators. You're going to need them. If I'm going to look like a Smurf tonight. Everybody's going to be. Oh, trust me. I've got this envelope today on you. Huh?
Do you know all the songs?
Pretty much.
Awesome.
I grew up on that. I remember the very first time I saw Willy Wonka in a Charlie and Chocolate Factory. It was at Liberty Elementary. Out South Salem. Mm-hmm. I was going to school down out there and had to go into Liberty. We went had a nice kind of thing there. I'll tell you what, man, that's the one thing that, I'll say this on camera too. That's the one movie that takes my kids and they are the most awful demons afterwards. I don't know what it is.
It's the boat ride.
It's something. It's something. And I actually got some books on Willy Wonka. I mean, I've got, you know, have some cool collector stuff. But I never really appreciated Johnny Depp until I really sat down and just decided to really watch it. And oh my goodness. He really did do a number on that show. He did do something totally different.
I'm glad that he tried to do a different type of Willy Wonka instead of trying to do something similar.
He didn't try. Somebody else made him do it. All right, so. Right? They paid him to do what he typically does.
I get the impression
that... The only time I thought, and it's on camera, so the only movie I thought Johnny Depp actually really played something totally different out of the norm. And I didn't know it was Johnny Depp.
Mm-hmm.
I had no idea it was Johnny Depp. It was in The Tourist. Angelina Jolie. And I had no idea it was Johnny Depp. I had no idea. It was outside of his norm. And I was like, wow, he hadn't actually act. You know, look at everything else. He was always the same character. Edward Scissorhands, you know, the pirate, blah, 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 all the same.
They're all under arrest, Thompson.
All right, so we have 50 minutes to get this done. We can
Cry
do
Baby
it.
Is different than the rest of them.
Huh?
Cry Baby.
And so is Blow.
Oh, I've never seen those.
Once Upon a Time in Mexico.
Anyway, electronics.
Give the man some credits.
Like, wait, he was
in that? You know,
Once Upon a Time in Mexico? Yeah, he's got took off his arm. That's who I wanted to be for Halloween this year.
Really?
Yeah, but yeah. I was Jack Skellington again.
Nice.
No, the character, the one at the end of the movie, he has the glasses on, blood going down his face because he has eyeballs taken out. Straight up.
100 ohms. 300
yes.
ohms.
Yes.
500 ohms.
Yes.
2 ohms. Go for it.
That's going to get some.
It's going to get too low.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 2.2 K ohms. 5.6 K ohms.
13 million.
3.4 K ohms. 6.5 K ohms. And 8.2 K ohms. Ooh. I have no idea where this is going to go to. But like Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, it's about the ride and the experience, right? We're gonna have it. We're gonna have a good time with this, right? Huh?
And free candy.
And free candy, right?
Augustus Luft.
All right, now.
Save some for later.
We're gonna do 100 volts on this. Yes. R1, R2, R3, R4, R5. R6, R7, R8. We're going to solve this thing. We're going to get down to the nitty gritty on this thing and get it done.
Violet, your turn in, Violet.
Stop.
But I want one now, Daddy.
All right.
They're talking about those trends coming back.
Oh, huh?
Those trends you're talking about coming back? I want Hypercolor shirts to come back.
Hypercolor?
Yeah, I do.
What's Hypercolor? The ones that get hot?
Yeah, the ones that change colors.
Those are awesome.
Yeah, I was trying to buy one. I looked all over.
Those jeans
like high-tech tie-dye.
Yeah,
high-tech tie-dye.
Do you remember those? Those are from like the late 80s, early 90s.
You know what? I got stopped at the airport. You want to talk about how that would help? I was stopped at the Eugene Airport, of all places. When I was going down to Arizona, and they actually took me to the side because I had this hot spot in the back of my shoulder, but that's where I've been driving. I was all hot and sweaty down there, so the guy had to pat me down and check me out. It wasn't, I'll tell you what, that was not the, after 9/11, I had a flight to Indianapolis, and I actually had such a very thorough
flight. Remember that one, huh?
I remember that one. And I did not know my rights at the time. I did not know that I could pick the person who I wanted to check me out. Next time I will.
Not taking the big guy again?
No. I was in prison. I'm serious. Hey, folks, I went through the check. I went through, TSA with my bag. And they not only checked my bag at that time, but they also checked me out at that point. They should have given me a great big huge rubber stamp on the forehead and said, safe. But instead of safe, it was scarlet. Because I got to the gate, and I was going on, and they pulled me to the side again. And checked me out once more. And that was pretty thorough. And, I felt like it was, I'm giving everybody time to do this. So again, stories are a good thing, okay? And, it was very thorough. And I got into Denver. And I went to board my next flight, and the lady in front of me got pulled to the side. The lady in front of me, and she was yelling all sorts of stuff, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, thank God it was you, not me. That's all I've done. I've had it. All right, so we can do all sorts of solving and stuff. Let's not worry about these guys up here right now, okay? Let's break out this circuit right here. We're going to label these guys up. We're going to label that A. Label is B, label is C, label is one D. Now, do you guys want to go for the top triangle or the bottom triangle?
Let's start at the top.
Start at the top? All right. So let's redraw this thing. And hopefully everybody's got these numbers. It's going to be a lot easier to do. I'm going to come over here. I'm just going to redraw this portion of it.
What portion of
it? This right here. A, B, C, and D. And C to D is going to have that 8.2 K ohm. B to D is going to Okay, 6.5 kaon. I'm gonna make this new one, right?
RA.
In a different permanent marker. RA, because it's gonna be a joined up A, I'm gonna call it that. Over here, I'm gonna have RB. And over here, I'm gonna have RC. I have no idea what those values are yet, other than they are actually related to these guys over here, okay? So to figure out what RA is going to do, and B, I'm going to take the 2.2K, which is going to be on one side, and the 5.6K on the other side, and use those. So I'm going to say that RA is equal to 2.2 kΩ times 5.6 kΩ divided by the sum of all of those three on the outside, which was a 2.2 plus a 5.6, and the last one was a 3.4. Right? I've got all my values there now, so I'm golden. So 2.2 kΩ times 5.6 kΩ divided by 2.2 plus 5.6 plus 3.4 is 11.2 kΩ in the bottom. I know it's 11.2 kΩ in the bottom. I'm not gonna see. That's gonna be meg. Let's see, 12.32 meg?
Yeah.
Okay, divided by 11.2, okay?
Is 1.1 K.
It's gonna be equal to 1.1 kΩ. So this guy right here is gonna be equal to 1.1 kΩ. RB, you see how that's done? To get this one here, we're gonna take the resistor that would have been here and down here and do the same thing. Now we know the bottom side because it's gonna stay the same at this point, 11.2 kΩ. And the upper part is gonna be RB, which is the 2.2 and the 3.4. Times 3.4 kΩ. Which is going to be equal to
667.86 ohms.
Okay, so what I did was I took for RB, which is going to be right here, right? I'm looking at R3 and R5, 2.2 and 3.4, right? Silence is compliance.
So RC will be R4 and R5?
Exactly. RC will be R4 and R5. Yes. Which is going to be 5.6 and 3.4. So it's going to be RC is going to be equal to 5.6 kΩ times 3.4 kΩ divided by the 11.2 kΩ again. Which is equal to?
1.7 kΩ.
How much?
1.7 kΩ.
Right. So RC is 1.7 kΩ. RB is 667.86 ohms. So now we have some series resistances, right? We've got this 1.7 kΩ plus 8.2 kΩ, right?
Mm-hmm.
Series resistance. So let's draw this A. RA is going to stay right here. So 1.7 kΩ plus 8.2 kΩ is 9.9 kΩ, correct?
Correct.
Right, 1.7 plus 8.2? On the other side, I have 667.86 plus 6.5 kOhm, which is going to be what?
7.167 kOhm.
And those are in parallel, right? So RA, which is 1.1 kOhm here, is going to be in series with the parallel resistance of that, which is 7.167 kOhms in parallel with 9.9 kOhms, which is
4.16.
What was that, Brianna?
4.16 kOhms.
4.16 kOhms?
Yeah.
Anybody else?
4.157
kOhms. 4.16. Sounds great to me. All right. Now I have a simple series circuit again, correct? But let's take this all the way back here. I've got from A to D, in reality, from A to D, I have this 1.1 kOhm, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I have this 4.16. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
From A to D. And down here, I've got 500, I've got 100, 300. And I've got 100 volts applied. Now, folks, let's not try to solve everything. Let's say we need to know what's in here between, you know, R5, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's where our goal is to get right down to the meat. So A to D, if I solve that, I can say that I've got 1.1 plus 4.16, right? Which is 5.26 kOhms, correct?
Mm-hmm.
That's the total resistance from A to D, 1.1 to 4.16.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we just did all the way over here, right? RA and its equivalent resistance over here.
Now we can use the voltage divider formula.
And then we want to use the voltage divider formula. And I'm going to say that I have 5.26 kOhms divided by the total resistance, which is going to be 5.26 plus 100, 5.3, plus 300, which is 5.66, plus 500, which is 6.16 kOhms. Total resistance is going to be 100 plus 300 plus that equivalent resistance plus that one. And I'm going to multiply it by 100 volts to find out the voltage between A to D.
85.39.
Anybody else agree? I'd say it's pretty close because look how big that resistance is, right? 5.26, right? kOhms. How much do we have out here?
800.
Less than 1,000, right? At 900 ohms out there.
So that the 4.16 kOhm was the resistance?
Was the parallel resistance here.
Okay.
And this RA we just brought down from all the way from up here. Okay. So I have 85.39 volts from A to D. From A to D. Right?
Mm-hmm.
From A to D. Now, what I'm going to do is, I want to split this way back right here, because I want to know the voltage right here. This will be a big one for me. I've got 85.39 volts from here to here. It's the same spot, right? It's across here. Same spot here, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So let's find the voltage right here. Okay, the voltage across the 4.16. So if I have, look way over here, 85.39 3.39 volts multiplied by the 4.16 k ohms divided by the sum of those two, which is the 5.26 k ohms, and that's going to give me the voltage across here. Well, 5.26. It's going to give me the voltage across this parallel resistance here.
67.53.
So, I have, from at this point here, 67.53 volts. That's this point right here, right?
Yes.
Is this point the same?
Yes.
You guys all see that? Do you see that?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. This point is the same thing as that point there, because these two are right here, correct? These two are right here. So this point and this point is the same, and this point's got 67.53 volts here. All right. We're way closest, because I've got 67.53 volts here. I have a voltage divider formula here too. Right? I've got 1.7K here and 8.2K on this side. And I know that the sum of it's 9.9K. So, if I have 67.53 there, 67.53 volts times the quantity. Now, I'm looking at this bottom one. I want this bottom one. I want the voltage across this. I want the voltage across this 8.2 k ohm. 8.2 k ohms divided by, and the sum of those two is 9.9, right? 1.7 plus 8.2 is?
9.9
k ohms. And that's going to give me a voltage of?
55.94.